Welcome everybody at another AMA on the Seedify HODLer YouTube channel. We are here again tonight with Hololoot. Hololoot, as you guys already know, launched through Seedify in December 2021. They held their IGO with us, and they have launched their project and their token at the same time in December. We are in July now, July 2022. We are almost 7 months in with Hololoot. We just want to welcome them back on our channel because they have been through many changes within their project. So they have been developing their platform, their product basically. So we are here to keep you all informed about what is currently going on within Hololoot. So we are here with Mati Savacik from Hololoot. Nice. Thank you for being with us here. Nice having Thanks you here. So we clearly already know you, perhaps the people within Seedify HODLers that haven't watched the previous AMA or haven't participated in the IGO before don't know you yet. So can you please tell us in a few words who you are again, and what are you doing within Hololoot?
Sure thing. So thank you for having me. I'm happy to be here again. A few facts about me. My name is Maciej Szafarczyk. I'm 30. I live in Lisbon, Portugal. I moved here from Poland. I'm Polish originally, and I am the chief operating officer and the co-founder of Hololoot. And my main activities revolve around making sure that everything flows smoothly on each and every front.
Let's just move on to what has been happening over the last months, basically, since your IGO and your launch. You know, what have you been mainly working on, and what does Hololoot currently have for the public to use? Like, have you developed a mobile application, a web application? What kind of assets, NFTs, are there for the public to see, to use? Are they free? Do they have to pay for them? So what have you done for product development since the launch?
All right. So I would say that the last couple of months we've been learning a lot, especially when it comes to you know, Web3 development. I have to say that we have entered the market with a Web2 mentality. We had to switch a few things. And I would say at this point, we are in a much better position. From a product perspective, we have launched the cloud service. However, we have decided not to open it up to everyone. And the reason for that is that we have decided that the content moderation side of things and the legal things do not allow us to do that just yet. So we have decided to cut it into three stages. The first stage being us as the users of the cloud service. Second stage as allowing certain institutions, whitelisting them to use the infrastructure. And the third stage would be to, you know, decentralizing it completely and allowing everyone to use it at their own will. So there's a couple of things that we've been tweaking in that regard. But at this point, what our cloud service allows is you can upload 3D models and you can mint these 3D models into AR NFTs. We have built our own minting service. This minting service runs on Binance Smart Chain, but we are also looking into Ethereum and Polygon. And at a certain point, we wanted to also integrate with Engine. This was one of our kind of key points. However, Engine is also shifting to Affinity. So I would say that most of the Engine-related products are nowadays legacy. They're switching all of their attention from Engine to Affinity. So we want to get on board of Affinity. And we are at the stage of testing their new wallet, for example. So we're still heavily in contact, especially on the business marketing side. On the technical side of things, we are waiting for them to release more products for us to be able to integrate with. We are also looking at Immutable X, that also has a very good community going on. So the NFT minting service, and we have also built our own marketplace. It's actually more of a shop, I would say, because it only allows us at this point to sell NFTs one way, from our side to end users. We will be tweaking this marketplace into an I Know Launchpad, and we will be developing a new version of the marketplace that will allow for auctions to be held, and you know, all the kind of regular things that you would find on this OpenSea template that they have released for public use not long ago. So we want to add more functionalities to the existing marketplace. But we also have integrated that with the cloud. So right now you can mint the NFTs, and you can you can create an offer on the marketplace. So it's all interconnected, and this this shop, this marketplace, is actually in the AR app. So once you upload something on the cloud, you can mint it, create an offer. It's going to be automatically sent into the AR app. You're able to, from the AR app perspective, you're able to enter it, view different offers, and buy it. So we have launched a few collections, AR NFT collections. Some of them you have to pay for. However, I think today or tomorrow, we will be releasing to the public a module that we have called community minting or claiming. This basically allows you to get your hands on an AR NFT just for the cost of the gas price, which is on Binance Smart Chain. So the gas price is a fraction of a BNB. And this way we want to give access to the AR NFTs to more people who couldn't basically afford the paid NFTs. However, we don't want to, and if I talk too much, then please we don't want to damage the trust that people who have paid for the NFTs. So we have this, decided to come up with a game, maybe at the end of the year, maybe later on, depending on the market conditions, really, and our readiness to launch it. But I think I would like to talk about it more in detail, maybe a bit later on. So to put it short, people will have access to the free NFTs. Some people have the paid NFTs. Those people who have the paid NFTs will be rewarded in a sense. I think that's it when it comes to the product. I think that's the essence.
Yeah, for the product part, we'll get to some details at the later stage. It's at least very good to see that you guys are still very busy at the moment, developing the product in the back end, 6 months later, 7 months later, almost after the launch. So as we all have seen, the market is changing at the moment. We have clearly seen 2021. Where a lot of blockchain games and blockchain gaming related projects performed really strong. There was a lot of trust in the market, a lot of VC stepped into the market investing. And in the same time, in the same year, but also after that, at the start of 2022 until now, we realized that actually many of these virtual economies are not as sustainable as expected. So when you look at these developments of 2021, how is your vision on those developments where you have seen those projects thrive and then their virtual economies eventually not so strong? And how do you see Hololoot adjusting to these changes in the market?
I think it's very tough in a sense that I think a lot of blockchain virtual economies are built on the Ponzi scheme, basically. So it's as long as you are inviting more people to the table, and you're able to, you know, basically input more cash than you're outputting, you know, you're fine. But if something happens on the macro level, let's say, as it's happening right now, and this kind of balance is shaken, then, you know, it's very easy for the, for those economy to collapse. I was actually contemplating this a lot. You know, I play a little bit of Age of Empires 4, and I would say that if Age of Empires 4 was a blockchain game, it would have flopped, because at the release, it had like, I think it was like 16 or 20 or maybe 30,000 players, and these days you have like 4,000. You know, and even the professional players are moving on to the next thing. You know, and then and I think. I think it's a matter of a business model and being reasonable about the longevity of the virtual economy. You know, I think a lot of projects have overpromised on the longevity. At the same time, I would say that there's so many gamers on the market. You know, the market is so huge, surpassing the video or music industry, that maybe some of those companies were actually just they were optimistic, you know. For example, if Axie had like 3 million players, maybe they were hoping for 30 million. And I think that might have been not completely insane. You had like World of Warcraft, you know, being played by 14 million people at the same time. So I think in our case, you know, we are, Hololoot is more of an infrastructural project. It's not a game, so there's different rules to it in a sense. The kind of play to earn game that we are developing, we're actually facing with this issue, I would say, and I think the answer to it is letting people know that the game will eventually end. And that the returns will decrease over time, if you don't put more money into the project, and that can vary, you know. So one of the ideas that I had, and maybe it's gonna sound stupid, I don't know, I would like to bounce it off with you, but I was thinking, like, why not make it season based? You know, I think Sandbox is doing that actually.
Season based is really good, actually. More games should do that.
To put a certain money in the pool, let people play it, and then finish it at a certain point and say, okay, there's gonna be season two if we get more funding, if we XYZ, but for now we're gonna learn from the season one, let's say.
Yeah, see the one thing I think that is a big struggle with blockchain games at this point is that when those games are launched, it feels like that the project founders believe that they have to expose everything they have on day one to the market, you know. So
yeah,
as soon as they list their token, basically, you know, it's it's important to bring people on board, you know. But if you look often at a white paper, in contrary to, for example, a traditional game, is that in the white paper they describe everything that you can do with an NFT, like every small little detail that a person can do with that NFT, like breeding, upgrading, leveling up. It's all in the white paper. But if you look at a traditional game, look at Diablo, for example, usually all those things are written by the community. You know, the community steps into the game, they are playing, they know nothing about the game, they are exploring. Often they choose a character, they mess up, then they start with another character, they explore again, don't make the same mistakes again, choose different power roads, for example, different skill roads, and then they share guides with each other about it. And this is something that you don't see in blockchain gaming. You know, it's like developers believe, like, you know, the market needs to know every little detail about our product before we launch, because then the impact is the biggest. And then after that, it usually goes down because the market already knows everything. Yeah. There's nothing to explore. You know, there's not the seasonal aspect that you're mentioning, you know, where, you know, people jump into something for 3 months, and then after 3 months, there's going to be something new or something different or an upgrade where they have to basically re-explore.
Yeah, that's a very good point. But it's also kind of like a market standard to expose everything, you know? But you're very right. This actually goes against the principle of decentralization, you know? Because the game design should also be decentralized to a certain point. That's a very good remark. And at this point, it's extremely centralized. Like, this is the way to play it. Play it or don't, you know? Everybody talks about community, but there's not enough interaction with the community. You're right. I will definitely take this lesson with me for the next adventure.
So let's hope that projects are changing to that, and because it has to become more attractive, and especially if you're a project that's focused on infrastructure, you know, you're basically, in a way, you're more resilient, but in a way also more dependent, you know, because if those projects do not adapt to the market, you know, I mean, you can be resilient, but you depend on those that are not resilient and either collapse or, you know, don't evolve, don't change. And if they don't make those moves, then you guys can't, you know, provide the services that they require, because they may only exist for 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, and there's no opportunity to build a sustainable relationship. So when you look at Hololoot itself, so... As you can see that also observe is that a lot of outsiders of a project look at a price development of the whole market, Bitcoin, Ethereum. People are looking at the mainstream coins and tokens at the moment. But of course, they're also looking at the other projects like Hololoot in this example. And so when you look at price development and then Hololoot, and especially since the launch, for example, there's an initial price, an IDO price. People are expecting, you know, the price will go up over time. If you look at Hololoot in this regard, would you like to share something to the community in relation to your price development experience over the last 7 months and in relation to the market?
Well, I think, you know, when we were launching, we didn't have, and I would say that we still don't have a very good mechanism that would buy back the tokens or burn them. So, you know, the inflation kind of kept growing. And also, you know, the institutional players, they were cashing out on the investment that they made at the beginning. And then, you know, with the market collapsing, I think a lot of people also panicked and exit even more. So, you know, being a project leader, it's quite challenging because you have a couple of different, I would say, like sliders. You know, you have a certain portion of stable coins that you have raised through the fundraise. You have to upkeep your team, spend it on marketing services, and so on and so forth. So that provides you with growth necessary to attract more people to the token and keep the volume going up and down, and so on and so forth. But at the same time, if you want to survive the winter that might last up for 4 years, as the CEO of Binance said, but it might be 2 years, might be. Depends, really. Nobody knows. Then you have to have those stable coins on you, you know, and you have to kind of slow things down. You cannot. I think a lot of people don't understand how expensive marketing is. We got a lot of bad rep for not pushing the marketing hard enough and so on and so forth. But like, you know, the thing with bull market is that, and I think the reasons why bull market happens is that things are overpriced and things are overhyped. And even the KOL rates, you know, they have changed drastically over the last couple of months. You know, all of the marketing services, I would say it's like 80% down. You know, so I think you know, we've reached like almost $1 at one point. So I think a lot of people also cashed out at that moment. You know, I think we also lost a little bit of momentum after entering MEXC. There was a huge dump coming afterwards. And it's hard to pick up after the momentum has died. But we've decided to, you know, take it as it is, learn from it. We've also gained a lot of experience from surviving this tough period. And I think that we're going to be able to pick it up. And as the market conditions, you know, change, I think that we're going to focus on building now, mostly. And as the market conditions go in favor for us, and I think the AR becomes more dominant as a technology, I think we're going to pick up more. There's a couple of investors who, I mean, you know, if you look at the token price at this point, you know, it's standing at 3 cents for quite a long time now. It's not going up. It's not going down. If investors had no faith in us whatsoever, I think they would have killed us at this point. So I think, and I've talked to a bunch of them, and they're saying that they're staking the tokens and basically waiting for better times. So I think it's coming. You know, I think we have survived the worst. Maybe we have not performed as well as we would have expected. It's going to sound extremely cliche, but I think the best is yet to come. So, you know, if there's any CD5 holders watching this that invested in us at the idle price, I would suggest you to keep on going with us. But this is just my word, you know. Of course, the numbers are against us. I don't know. What is your take, if you could share your opinion?
In my opinion, now is a good market to, like you said already, it's a good market to build. It is unaffordable where we are right now. And it's not just us that are perhaps seeing our own projects going down in performance. It's the whole market, and it's not just the crypto market that is currently suffering from this. I mean, it's the global macro economy, U.S. inflation sitting at 8%, for as far as I know, the central official bank interest going up, you know, for...
That's the official rate, yeah.
Exactly, the official rate. So it reflects the current status of the economy. So it's not just in crypto, it's like there's too much money in the economy right now. There was too much money in the economy over the last 2 years, basically, to stimulate the basically to avoid the economy from collapsing. I think that's fair to say.
Yeah, like a zombie economy.
Central banks. What's that?
Yeah, like a zombie economy. You know, staying alive. Yeah.
Exactly, because everyone was panicking. Everyone all of a sudden had to work from home. They had no idea what to do. Companies had no idea what to do. They had no idea how to arrange the right work environments for their employees to keep them going. Production stopped. Prices went up. Then production came back. Then a war started. Production went up again. Export, import is changing. And it's just also it came to crypto. Okay. Of course, we have this cycle in crypto where we have winter, we have bear, we have bull. Now we are, I think it's fair to say, we are in bear market. It's a negative market in that way from a price perspective, but it's also a healthy development and one that we as builders of solid projects should not forget. If you have a solid project at your hands, you have a solid team behind you, you know that you are building on something that's not just for temporary, because you are in a market where you want to make change. And with Hololoot, that's what you are trying to do. You are in augmented reality. Augmented reality is a massive market, maybe even bigger to come than a virtual reality, for example, because virtual reality in ways is very limited in relation to augmented reality. So it's a massive marketing. It's used by a lot of companies to promote their product, to entertain their users, to entertain their gamers. So there's a lot of potential there. So it's all about the value of the product at this point. So if you're looking at the token price, the price may be sitting low, but it's the product quality that is important. And you are having a solid team. You are convinced that you want to build something during this market, and that is very important right now. So keep on building, keep on the faith that you're building on something good that the market is going to use, and above all, partnerships also, which we will get to shortly. But for now, so when we are looking at the market, which we just did, and then we're looking at business development, for example. So then we're talking about this whole building part. I believe on your website you mentioned that there is a test happening with the Hololoot AR app for different devices. I mean, if you use it for Apple, for Android, also for Mac, for laptops. So people can download the Hololoot AR application there. So could you explain to all of us what the purpose of the test application is, how long it runs for, and what to expect when the testing is finished?
Sure. So I would only specify that it's mobile devices. It's designed for mobile devices. So MacBooks and PCs, you can access the cloud using those devices, but the AR app is only for iOS and Android mobile phones. And so we are in the testing phase. There's a couple of reasons behind it. One of the main ones is that there's not a clear kind of legal take on profit distribution within App Store and Google Play Store. If you look at what happened with Fortnite and the virtual bucks, you will see what I mean by that. Axie Infinite has about 800,000 people using the app on the test flight. They haven't yet moved onto the kind of regular store. So we were like, okay, so if they didn't do that, you know, who we are to kind of go above the radar. So we're staying in the test apps for one of those reasons. And secondly, we're not yet ready with all of the functions. So we are testing it with the people. Previously we gave the access to iOS users. We got a couple of hundred people who have downloaded it. And now, but we had a lot of voices. We did a poll also asking which devices people are using. And most of them voted for Android. We were scared to release the app for Android because there's so many devices. There's like 216 different devices that support AR, whereas on iOS side, it's just a couple of them. But we were like, okay, it's now or never. You know, let's see how it will behave, and but it's you know, launching it on so many devices has to breed errors. You know, and also, the mobile version of the MetaMask is also prone to errors. We've seen a lot of stuff happening there, and we basically have to first to conduct more tests for us to be able to launch it completely and be proud enough to sign our names underneath and say this is a ready product. So we wanted to deliver as much value as we can to the people without sacrificing the quality. And this is why we took the path that we have went for. So at this point, you can access the core functionalities. So access the marketplace. You can see the kind of library of the NFTs that you already have. You can claim your free NFTs, and you can play with them in the augmented reality. And there's a bunch of new functions coming along, and we're going to be informing the people as we release them.
Okay, that's good. So. I think this is also playing a major role for partnerships that you have built over the past time and partnerships that you are going to build. So currently you have partnerships standing with Engine, Scotty Beam, and CryptoBlades, and you're also releasing, I think you mentioned it at the start of this AMA, your own AR game called Crypto Zoo.
Yes, that's the plan.
Can you give us a bit more information about the benefits for the users of these partnerships? Right. Assuming, for example, CryptoBlades or your own upcoming game, CryptoZoo.
So Engine is one of our main partners, one of the biggest investors. We are looking onto integrating with Affinity. It's going to be, I think, quite of a game changer when cross-chain NFTs will actually will materialize, so to say. Right now, it's still under development. When it comes to Scotty Beam, they're providing an infrastructure that allows you to teleport different NFTs to different chains. So we are working close with them too, and we will be releasing an AR NFT collection that will have certain functionalities kind of installed into them. So they will give you some kind of discounts within the Scotty Beam suite and so on and so forth. We will be releasing more information about this partnership soon. I think we're also cooking up a competition together, like a competition for the users of our both products. As with CryptoBlades, we have released our own sword within their game, so you can actually use this game, use this sword inside of the game, and so the same kind of AR NFT that you can see in your room in our app, you can play with it in the CryptoBlades game. You know, so this was a first type of this integration, and we want to have more partnerships like that. So we have a bunch of new projects coming up, and we will be revamping our website. And on the website, there's going to be a section called partnerships. And over there, you will see the entire list of projects that we're talking to. But I think at this point, it's ranging up to like 30 different prospects that we're talking to and testing out the different models and trying to find some kind of a cooperation that is beneficial for both sides. So there's a lot of cooking that's being done on the BDM side. You know, there's a dedicated person, Philip, that we have introduced to the community not long ago, and he's working around the clock to reach as many new game projects, crypto game projects as possible. After that is finished, we're gonna move to traditional gaming. Then we want to move to artists, crypto artists first, and then traditional artists, because there's also space for them. It's not just a gaming kind of infrastructure. And then we want to reach out to brands, both crypto and traditional brands. So there's plenty of kind of B2B space that we can cater and you know, partner with.
Okay, thank you. And when you look at the crypto shoe, what is the crypto shoe in a few words?
So I'm a bit shy with it still because it's fresh out of the oven. But I think the plan was is to have your own kind of collection of animals in your own very zoo. It's a little bit like Cryptomon, I believe, a little bit like Tamagotchi, and you would be building your own kind of zoo in augmented reality, perhaps in 3D and 2D version too. If we see that a lot of people cannot access AR, you know, we don't want to make a product that is not being able to be used because there's so we're still kind of trying to gauge that. And in return, we have envisioned that those animals would provide you with rewards in a given token. You know, so let's say that we, you know, start off the experience with Etherinos. You know, your mission would be to obtain the Etherinos. Part of them would be obtainable through Pixel, which is the kind of other reward token. You can gain it. The plan is for you to be able to either buy whole tokens and stake them to get the Pixels, or to do certain things within the app to get the Pixels for free. So we also want to have this kind of incentive system built in the app that will reward you for doing certain missions and give you Pixels that in turn you can use for the to obtain the animals. And you know, your mission would be to check on them daily, keep them happy, entertained, healthy, and they would have a certain algorithm that, depending on the on certain conditions, would give you more or less virtual tokens in return. This token pool would be fixed, so from the get-go you would know how many tokens are you getting for taking care of those animals. Of course, it has to be designed in a way that it doesn't trigger the SEC, so these NFTs are not seen as securities. So there's also still a lot of work on the conceptual side, but like, this is the kind of gist, you know. And then we wanted to introduce other projects to this kind of crypto zoo. So we wanted to talk to, for example, like AVAX, and tell them, hey, this is what we're doing. We can expose your project to new people through this game. What you would have to do is provide us with a certain portion of tokens, which then would be redistributed to the people playing the game. And it's going to last for a certain amount of time. The season one will last for, let's say, a year. And after that, you know, we're going to change the animals, change the kind of the scenario, or even, you know, finish the game. It's really something that has to be thought through, because the promise that most blockchain games give to investors and gamers is that they're going to last forever. You know, and I think that's an overestimation. You know, I don't want to create something that is stupid and not useful by the people, but at the same time, I don't want to also overpromise. So we're looking for a conceptual middle ground, so to say. You know,
I think what people want to see is a product that they feel that they can use. Which leads us to our next question, where we can see AR evolves around mobile phones. There are also augmented reality glasses that integrate basically assets, items, NFTs into the real world. So what can users expect from Hololoot in regards to these type of integrations? Like, for example, of course, we have the NFTs from CryptoBlades. Let's say there's a sword. We can use it in the game. However, augmented reality focuses on basically taking that sword, bring it into real life, you know, invite a friend. You both have a sword. You walk into a building or a forest, you know, or just in an arena where you have a sword fight together. So how is Hololoot going to approach these integrations?
Well, it's still fairly young for the AR glasses, I would say. We are in talks with one of the Chinese manufacturers, one of the biggest players, but we have not yet been able to strike a partnership that we can announce publicly and have a kind of like a concrete plan for the integration. So, but if that happens, it's going to be great. However, the point that you have mentioned is about shared AR experiences. You know, in the ecosystem of Hololoot, we also have a part that is called the AR Metaverse. Right now, it's very limited. It's basically an AR viewer. You can view the assets, but we eventually want to introduce more experiences there. So something that you can, you know, interact with more. So games are one type of interactive experiences, but you can also have, I would imagine, some kind of AR ads or interactive trailers for upcoming projects, or social AR experiences, which I think is going to be the driving force behind the adoption of AR. So definitely, if you could share your AR NFT library with your friends in the same kind of physical spot, that would be beneficial. We are in talks with one solution provider who actually focuses on this. It's also a Web3 company, so we might be also integrating with them in this regard.
Yeah, I think that integration is going to be very important for the public, because the public to interact with the project requires basically a social environment where multiple people can be together and experience the benefits of the augmented reality, the assets, the NFTs in this case. So I think everybody is really looking forward to see that kind of development happening. So right now, let's move from this business development part. Let's move into the virtual economy. So you speak about a dual token economy in your white paper, which evolves around the a whole token and the pixel token, whereas part of the pixel token is that it is used as a reward for staking the whole token. I could see it's for single whole staking provides then pixel tokens to the people, to the stakers. So what can they do with these pixel tokens within your ecosystem?
Well, at this point, you know, the main kind of benefit of having Pixel is that you can get access to free NFTs. So this is what we have. This is the kind of newest function that we have implemented. There's different tiers to do those free NFTs. There's certain NFTs that you can get for free without any kind of virtual assets on you. Some you can only get if you have a certain amount of HOL token in your account to kind of give more opportunities to HOL holders. And some can be accessed through Pixel tokens. So we have just launched a competition where you can win, I think it was $2,000 for creating the kind of most scary AR experience, you know? So you have a certain amount of assets that you can place around in your living area. You can, you know, come up with some kind of a scenario, what to do with them. And, you know, you can basically win this cash and share your creation with the community. You know, and in order to kind of, you know, give more chances to the people who support us by having the tokens, we have decided that this, some of the, you know, kind of premium NFTs can be gained through, you know, having these tokens. And that in turn would make, you know, your chances of winning the competition higher because you would have more assets at your disposal. So it's just one of the ideas that we had recently, and along the way, the Pixel token will be used to, for example, you know, buy, you know, assets. Maybe not buy, but like obtain assets within the AR metaverse. This is still heavily under development, so we're looking for the best solutions for that. However, you know, I can tell you that this is coming on the horizon. So in case of this game, for example, we have envisioned that, you know, some of the assets you could purchase with stable coins, for example, but some of the assets like food or toys or accessories to kind of build the zoo with, you know, or medicine, you can obtain with the Pixel tokens that you can get for completing certain missions. So you don't have to necessarily pay to play the game. You can interact with the game and get rewarded with the Pixel token, and then spend it on playing the game without spending the actual stable coins. So, you know, there's a lot of conceptual work going on there, and you know, soon we will release more things once we have it ready.
That sounds really good. Yeah, it would be really cool if people are staking their HOL tokens, and by staking a certain amount of HOL tokens, you know, clearly they get the Pixel tokens, they can purchase NFTs, but by just staking those HOL tokens, they will get like access to a particular NFT or environment. It doesn't even have to be an NFT, in my opinion. It can also be like staking 10,000 HOL tokens provides you access to a custom-made arena where they can invite their friends. They can purchase other NFTs with their Pixel tokens, invite their friends into their arena, and then have a show of there, or the events that you are describing, organizing events, so they invite their friends, or everybody showcases their own arena. And then
one thing I have to add is this is the B2C kind of side of things, and our infrastructure is B2B2C. So also staking the HOL on the B2B side will, for example, allow you to have your assets in the game. For example, it's a form of an AR ad, you know, that it's a form of a metaverse as a service, in a sense. You know, you have a certain amount of tokens within the ecosystem, you get some kind of rewards. You know, you can mint your AR NFTs to a certain amount. You know, there's a limited amount that you can have on the infrastructure. You know, and you can have, let's say, multiple skins given to one particular asset, and so on and so forth. So there's a lot of micropayments that we want to introduce both on the B2B and the B2C side. And I would say that the HOL token gives you access to the infrastructure on the B2B, and Pixel is used for the reward system in the B2C, if I could just put it in the essence, like summarize it.
Yeah, so let's move on to that B2B part. So you also mentioned that you have B2B marketing bundles for companies. So can you explain what these marketing bundles are, and how are you bringing those to the market to other companies?
Right. So what we want to do is we want to push the envelope for NFTs with immersive technology. So we want to make the AR NFTs, you know, as widely popular as classical NFTs. But it's hard to do it when you have a limited, capital, and you're basically a small project as we are at this point. So we're trying to devise, clever ways to basically boost our presence, our range of services, and so on and so forth. That's why we have, envisioned this Aino Launchpad. And Aino Launchpad will be more of a structuralized way to launch AR NFT collections to the market. And a part of this Aino Launchpad efforts to reach as many people as possible is to conduct marketing services before that. So I think these two things are interconnected, and we have decided that we also want to earn some cash from the B2B side, to put it bluntly, through these services, so we can also buy back and then burn some of the HODL tokens. So we, before the marketplace, the AR NFT marketplace, functions properly to a degree that allows us to be sustainable financially, we want to make some moves on the B2B side and basically, offer a good service to B2B clients, give them exposure to new B2C clients, but also reward the holders of the HODL token with the buying back action and the burning of the HODL token, to kind of cause more deflectionary action. It has not happened yet, but we're working on that.
Thank you for that. We're just gonna move on to a bit different subject here right now. So we just discussed a bit about the virtual economy, the tokens, the business to business features in relation to that part. Now let's just move to the augmented reality versus virtual reality. So they are both making big moves within gaming and blockchain gaming, are actually in the entire market. It's not only for gaming. So since you are in augmented reality, what is your view in relation to the adoption between those two when it comes to augmented reality adoption and virtual reality adoption?
I think these two technologies will exist side by side. I think you will have people who actually prefer metaverse more to actual reality, and maybe that's a bit stigmatized these days, but I think a lot of people can look for some kind of, I'm not sure how to phrase it properly, shelter or like an alternative to physical reality, which is also falling apart, kind of, if you look at things globally. So I think there's going to be some kind of like physical reality deserters moving on to virtual reality and just kind of leaving the physical reality for the virtual reality. And I've been a VR user myself. I haven't gotten my hands on a VR headset here in Lisbon yet, but I'm contemplating it. Yeah, but I think it's going to be a niche at the end of the day. I think a lot of people, the kind of mainstream adoption, the kind of normies, I think they're going to go for AR simply because it's not so overwhelming from the sensoric perspective. You can still do your thing. You can see your AR hologram. It's a lot of AR solutions will be intertwined with physical reality, whereas in VR the physical reality doesn't matter at all. I expect the AR to be the dominant technology. However, I think these two technologies will have different use cases, and I think a lot of corporate entities will push both. You have some movement on Apple, in the Apple stable, for example, and they're contemplating a mixed reality headset. So you can switch between VR and AR depending on what you want to do. And I think maybe that's one of the paths forward. If you want to have contact with AR, you can super, you can bring it up to the hyper reality level, so you can have AR and physical reality happening at the same time. But if you want to completely detach, you go into VR and you forget about physical reality. So I think this is the path forward. But it's just my take on it. You know, I'm not that close to the kind of decision making bodies to have an actual say in things. It's just my speculation.
Yeah, it probably depends on the type of people as well. As you say, for augmented reality, there is a market. And for virtual reality as well, there's different types of people. Some people are looking for more towards stepping out of the real world for a moment into a virtual environment where they can be whoever they want. And there's also people, when I'm imagining augmented reality, for example, is those fan clubs people that, you know, they dress up like knights and stuff like that, and they come together, you know, they play these medieval games on a Sunday afternoon, all dressed up, you know, having a barbecue or whatever. But in this case, they can have also augmented reality swords, for example. They can maybe have a more, you know, like this mixed experience between virtual reality, but still in the real world together, you know, all dressed up, you know, in those knight suits and medieval suits. And in the same time, they hold virtual items, which are then through the augmented reality technology placed into that real world with their real friends in a physical environment.
Yes. One thing I have to just add before I forget, and maybe some people will find it interesting, there's this upcoming game called Peridot. It's developed by Niantic. It's in a soft launch right now. Not many people have access to it. I unfortunately don't, but I've seen some footage, and it's also an example of an AR project that might be big eventually, because these are like your virtual companions that you travel the world with, and there's also like heavy machine learning, computer vision behind. So, for example, if you walk to a riverbank and you look at the water, you know, the device knows that it's water, and you can, for example, like fish fish water out of it with your pet, or you can make your pet to swim inside of the river. It's crazy stuff. I really recommend checking it out.
Okay, all right, thank you for everyone to know to go there. So let's just move on to the roadmap of Hololoot here. So what are your plans to move towards entering the market more deeply and aiming to become a more prominent player in the blockchain ecosystem as an AR platform?
So I have to tell you that the concept of a roadmap is nice when you want to communicate with investors on a very in a very simple term. You know, you set forward like certain quarters, and there's going to be some actions happening, and it's all nice and everybody's kind of happy. And then you get down to kind of the dirty side of things, they actually code stuff. And what I found is that my dev team, they actually prefer an agile approach to things. They don't want to have a certain like a fixed date on certain things, because you can, it's always, it's really hard to envision and plan out things if you are navigating a new technology that is blockchain plus AR. It's insanely complex. And maybe people will, you know, criticize me for this or something, but I'm, you know, at this point, I don't care, you know? So it's like, we have set for certain goals, but this roadmap, I would say, is movable depending on the business opportunities that we have on the horizon, and depending on the technological shifts. To give you an example, we've worked for a long time on the marketplace, and then you have OpenSea, who drops this kind of open version of the marketplace, you know, and the kind of entire thing is mixed up, you know. You have integration with Engine, but they're releasing Affinity, so basically, you know, all of the things are moving, and it's like constantly shifting, you know. But to not go too far from the actual question, this was like an intro. So what we have to push, we have to keep on upgrading the existing products. So this is the cloud service that we want to open up to more actors than just us. Then there's the AR app. We have received a couple thousand submissions for the Android version of the app. I think we might be able to actually accommodate everybody. We'll see. This is also going to be a stress test for the infrastructure. We are also integrated with some external providers like Morales or Microsoft Azure. We'll see how those players react to this traffic. So then we want to expand the Aino Launchpad, which will be the first kind of AR NFT Aino Launchpad on the market. We have a bunch of cool ideas when it comes to AR marketing there. And then we want to have this AR marketplace, this kind of full-fledged marketplace with all of the kind of classical functions that you can find on any other marketplace. So I think once we have that and then we add more functionalities to the AR metaverse, and then we move on to AR glasses, for example, and you have more brands adopting AR, more partnerships that we strike cooperation with, I think things will start to grow organically. And there's also one point I have to make, which might be obvious in a sense, but only now our entire team is synchronized in a sense that we have the marketing and the business development and the product development and the legal side of things and the crypto accounting and tax things and all of that kind of flowing in place. And it was very hard to be prepared before the launch to have everything in place. A lot of things kind of happened as we went forward, So at the end of the day, the price might not reflect it, but I think we've done a lot of work and we plan to do even more, and I think we're becoming more effective and more synchronized and more also experienced with the actual kind of harsh reality of the market conditions. So yeah, we'll see.
Exactly. It's good to hear. I mean, like you say, you have a good team together. You're all working nicely together, which is very important while you're building a good product. So as you say, it may not be represented at this point in the price for the token. The valuation may not be as you believe it should be, but the time will pick up on your product basically as you progress more towards making the actual application public, go through the testing, onboard more partners, expand the collaborations with the current partners, and basically focus also a lot on business to business marketing, where businesses are onboarded to use your AR environment to have marketing events through,
yes,
through or in collaboration with Hololoot. So it's just a matter of time, like we discussed in this AMA. So right now you are focusing on building. We're just all together sitting out this negative market right now. But if we all can survive this negative market, when the market is basically transitioning into back into growth, back into users that trust the market again, because the market has been evolving, the market has been changing, the bad projects are eliminated due to the negative developments right now, that the bad teams, they can't keep up because they were never building something, they were not focusing on making the ecosystem better. So it is very important for us that we keep building. I mean, we have seen in our intro here, our reflection over the last 6 months with Hololoot, that you guys have been constantly building. The market may be a bit negative, but your business development is strong. So you guys keep going there basically, and the economy is also solid. So it's just get through this negative market, and yeah, like I keep saying, keep building, keep promoting, and keep onboarding people. Make sure it looks like a fun project, because that's very important these days. Is that when users come on board with your project, they feel like, okay, yeah, we are having fun here, we are enjoying the time with each other. So looking at this entire AMA, all that we've discussed, Are there a few last comments that you would like to add? Is there anything else that you'd like to add before we head off and close this AMA?
Well, I wanted to thank you for the opportunity. We also had a little conversation before we have started recording. I thank you for that. And for all the people that have gathered around Hololoot, I strongly recommend you to stay with us. And I think I'm full of cliches today, but I have to say that I think the future is in immersive technologies when it comes to NFTs. And we want to be a part of it, and we are working hard to materialize it. So that's the best thing I can say about the project.
Thank you very much. Thank you for being with us. For everyone that has been watching or is watching, please don't forget to subscribe to our channel, like this video, share it with everyone, and share Hololoot with everybody. They're building a great product in relation to augmented reality. So definitely worth the share, definitely worth the like, and definitely worth the follow on both ends. Thank you, everybody, for watching, and I'll see you guys around.
Take care.